Guys, I'm not kidding. Cat's having hard times, actually. If you're watching this and you haven't donated,
you're a cat hater.
But that's okay. I like you. I'm glad you're here. Still glad you're here. Yeah, keep coming back. Maybe someday you'll feel like supporting
old Mr. Opera.
I work so hard for you. And what do you do for my cat?
Anyway. Okay. So if you want to use this neutral approach, you're going to need some ring somehow. And the way that guys get ring when they're using the neutral approach is, well, I guess the most important one is knurdle. The knurdle function. Knedleek. So the knedleek is not a knurdle. So you don't have to be afraid to use it if you want to do this sound. And let's get an idea of a phrase.
Von Wundertät kam Siegen.
You're gonna have to. You have to retract the tongue, but just not into area of interest number three. Instead, you retract it more into. Okay, it's area of interest number three, but not very deep into area of interest number three. Shall we say, you're not quite centered on area of interest number four, where you would go to do this peanut thing that I'm talking about. You're not really constricting area of interest number three enough to make twang, and then adding the pressure that would cause it to become metallic. But you get ring with some narrowing of area of interest number three. It's just that you're doing it higher up.
Now, if I really exaggerate this kind of thing, I can do this Kermit the Frog thing.
And there's another thing that you could do with. Now, I haven't totally worked out how this, but this kind of stitch cord, oh my god, this kind of coordination. So if you combine this with a little bit of knurdle,
Ziegen!
His is way better. He's a super successful guy. And I'm not a super successful guy, even though I can make metallic sounds. So, yeah. But if you want this to work, I guess, if you want to do this sound, you need these elements. And you need to get some ring somehow. And he does it with this thing. Lauritz Melchior does not.
Rein ein Gefäß von Wundertät kam Siegen.
In this case, I think it's more the first one that he's doing.
Von Wundertät kam
So you get metal in the sound by essentially you're pushing the chin chest and larynx together, or pulling them, you're making a kind of fist there. And that gives you a way to make the constriction that you need. And that's changing the way that the vocal folds vibrate, yada, yada, yada. The question is that necessary to sing Helden tenor roles? And what, like, what, or is it not? There is arguments that, oh no, Wagner just wrote his music for ordinary lyric voices. And I suppose when we have the kind of music scholarship that leads to Stefan Zucker, is that also what's leading to us needing to do this? And, like, it's not just that it doesn't sound heroic. It's that it doesn't sound heroic and they kind of, like, ram it down your throat. That it's like being... it's like being pegged by a castrato. That's actually a little bit how I feel when I listen to this. You know, like, Stefan Zucker got his way, sort of. And now we don't have the castrato, I guess, but we do. We have sound that sounds, see, almost identifies as castrato. This is complicated for me. It gives me a complex set of emotions. To listen to this, I guess it's a little bit easier, but then to process it and then talk to you guys about it and not get myself canceled and then also say something that's gonna help someone to sort out is this Helden or not? I guess you can figure out where I'm coming down on this, that calling this sound heroic, so what we've heard so far, is something like listening to Zucker and keeping a straight face, or listening to Zucker knowing it's terrible and then saying something like, oh, but what a brilliant musicologist. Like, oh, okay, nothing about the vowels are heroic, but listen to those heroic consonants. No one has aspirated a T that heroically since Wagner himself. I don't know. Let's hear a bit more, I guess. It's awfully good diction. Even some breathy sounds. I'm told by a colleague that actually this guy is really loud. His sound is huge. So maybe this has nothing to do with the whole chest thing, and it's just a misunderstanding that what makes the sound heroic is just volume as opposed to the character of it. I think it's the character, this character at any volume, it doesn't matter how loud you make it. It's not heroic. It's a non-hero who identifies as a hero sound. That's what it sounds like to me. And like, I also feel like I'm in a bit of danger kind of admitting that something is wrong here. And it is the like the official Mr. Opera policy is it's not my job. If you call me and you ask me for voice lessons, for instance, if you write to therealmr.opera@gmail.com, that's therealmr.opera@gmail.com, and you tell me what's on your mind, and one of those things on your mind is, can you help me get a bigger sound? Then I've got to tell you something honest that's actually going to help you do that. And if you call me and you say, I want to sound like this, it's not my job to tell you, no, you don't want to sound like this. Right? It's just my job to help you manage that. It ought not to be the role of the voice teacher to dictate to the student what it is that they came there to do. That's your job. You figure out what it is you want, and then you hired a consultant to help you do it. Okay, great. But they have a job. But I feel like Sony is a little bit like, I don't know, like forcing me to say that this is heroic. It's not heroic sounding. But at the same time, does that mean that I'm telling a bunch of people like they have to also think that this doesn't sound heroic? I guess no. I think you're entitled to your own opinion if you don't think that this sounds, if you do think that this sounds heroic. But I disagree with you. Same thing. We don't have the knurdle now. So I guess that's making the big difference between piano and forte. And I'm absolutely, for anyone who's telling me that I'm hating here, I'm not hating on anybody. I hope it doesn't come across that way. And if people like this, that's great. And they should. I hope they go to the opera. But I wonder if this is kind of forced here. I wonder if it's really a majority of people that are going to the opera and enjoying being forced to do this kind of identity spiel. Helden. Alljährlich naht vom Himmel eine Traum. It's like this. Well, I mean, it's just the same thing going on. Now we're coming to the loud part, I guess. Um neu zu stärken seine Wunderkraft, es heißt, er kann. It's loud, I'm sure. In terms of like the sound pressure level, and I'm sure he's also audible. So everyone's warning like you'll never be heard. He's probably audible. But it doesn't stand out in the mix, even here where they have all the engineers to throw at it. It just gets lost in the mix, and they're barely playing anything. The orchestra's barely playing anything, and the issue with it is not the loudness of it. It's the character of it. It's not, I don't know, not metallic. It's not metallic. In this situation, Lauritz Melchior is not being particularly loud, and you can see his mouth isn't particularly open. And I think we said he even opens the nose a little bit. Didn't we say? I think we said that. He's opening his nose a little bit to mellow the sound, to not make it too forte. Es heißt der Grund. It was something like that. Der Grell! Der Grell! I think we need to go back and watch. Let's go back and watch.
Songs for which he is best known.
Um neu zu stärken, deine Wunderkraft,
It was more in the opening and flaring the lips direction and with the peanut thing, I remember now.
Es heißt der Grell.
And it's, yeah, okay.
Der Grell.
It's not the super loudest thing in the world. It's not the most metallic thing in the world, but it's still metallic. Oh, hi, Kane. Welcome to Mr. Opera. I think this is the first time you stopped in, so welcome. I hope I'm not getting myself canceled here, Kane. So you better stand up for me if anyone's saying how mean I was to Klaus here. I still got to point out, like, I'm talking about someone way more successful than me, and it's a bad look in some ways. I understand. And maybe it's worth saying, if you're getting your start and you're doing what I'm doing right now, maybe that's okay. I'm not setting a good example for you, because you should be sitting there figuring out, what is he doing better than me? What is he doing better than me that I can steal? And, like, forget about all this stuff, right? But here, like, no, we need to talk about what is the basic vocal mode that's being used. And maybe we should also talk about, like, what are the considerations you need to have in mind if you're going to follow this path that Vogt is taking. Or if you're going to try to follow what Melchior is doing. I have to be completely, like, above board here. I could listen to Melchior, like, all day. And I know that video so well because I did that probably many times. Like, spent the day watching that on repeat. So I have an opinion about this that I think is right. And I think you should agree with me that this is not heroic. Okay. But still, how are we defining anything? And if it's not according to vocal coordinations, are we making messes? Total messes of things and winding up, like, now we're playing identity games and we're doing I'm a singer who identifies as Heldon, and I almost feel trolled, you know, with this stuff. But this does not work for me. So let's get this back and try any different vocal coordinations, or if it's just this the whole way. The velum is open for a lot of this, I would say, as well. So that, by that I mean the passage to the nose. So if you want to follow this path, then that's something to remember. And I guess a lot of this isn't possible with the nose completely closed. you'll find yourself getting a lot of like creaking and weird effects if you try to keep your nose completely plugged the whole time and you're singing in a neutral vocal mode. But if you're singing in a metallic vocal mode, like edge or overdrive, what CVT calls edge or overdrive, or we don't have to even use those words, if you just stick to a metallic vocal mode, you can not have the nose open and just keep it that way, unless you have N, M, or other consonant sounds that require the nose to be open. And if you're singing in French, you can even like fake your nasal vowels. You can get in touch. I can show you how to do that. Anyway. Now we have this. And if you want to do this, don't forget your knurtle, because you need that. It helps get the ring in your voice. That's the kind of stitch thing. On an U. Is that metal? Make it sound more heroic. So they're bumping up the 2500 to 3500 range on his audio, maybe. I don't know. It's just more of this the whole way, I guess. I guess we don't need to finish the aria. There's nothing of it. There's nothing going on other than this. But the question is this a good idea? And look, if your name is not Klaus Florian Vogt, I hope the answer is no. I hope this is going to be like a one-time thing that we have Heldon tenor that sings everything in neutral, because it's, to me, it's a gimmick. It's kind of a gimmick. Okay, I mean, he looks the part, so I guess maybe that has to do with it, that it's all about image, and if you look like this, then you can now be a Heldon tenor without sounding remotely heroic, even to the extreme that you could sing everything in neutral. And granted, the classical folks don't have this term, right? So whoever it is that identifies as a producer or whatever, who's forcing this stuff, whoever it is that's pushing this through, and it's more than one, it's not a conspiracy kind of thing or anything like that. It's just people see what other people are into, you know, and you know how fashion works, and fashion also affects people who are selling us stuff, and they're selling us this. Okay. One second, guys. I've got one of my fans is getting impatient because this live stream is getting long. So you're in the show now. Welcome to Mr. Opera. Okay. No, No, you need to behave. You need to behave. Okay, so... whoever's selling us this as Heldon, I guess they can do it much easier in a world where Stefan Zucker has defined chest and head voice for us. Where guys like Stefan Zucker can be taken seriously as musicologists, even sounding like that. And saying, okay, I apply my musicology stuff and this is the result. Okay. Wow, you must be a genius musicologist. In that world, we can get to the place where this is marketed as Heldon Tenor. And I guess we can for a time keep that going. But I'm wondering what happens to the average opera goer who goes to Lohengrin and they're sold this sound as the hero. And they look up there and they're like, wow, damn, he looks so tall. His piercing blue eyes. He looks like, you know, he reminds me there of, I grew up with Kevin Sorbo as Hercules on the CW. No, it wasn't the CW. I forget what the channel was. But we would watch TV like it wasn't even digital back then. And we had this Hercules series and he looked like this. It was like this strong, muscly guy with a mullet. But I don't know. I guess, he's not like a real Hercules. He's just an actor or whatever. But what is it that's giving you the hero in this situation, the hero situation, and for the audience? And so, Paul, yeah, I think you would feel cheated. I think the average person is going to feel cheated. Okay, yeah. We get all of our money for stuff from the German government and Austrian government and stuff, or from donors, and it doesn't matter what the average person in the audience feels, because whether they go to the opera or not, or what they think of it, doesn't matter. They're allowed to participate by getting a ticket, but they're not really who we're performing for. We're actually performing for like some kind of administrator guys or some kind of bureaucrat. And I think for a bureaucrat, you can get to this. This is Heldon. Because you can somehow, like, you can check a box. Well, he's loud enough. Maybe something like that, or the look, I don't know, or some guy at Sony's like, you know what the album cover is gonna look like? This dude with a sword. That's heroic. I guess something like that. But I think there's also this musicology cover, you know, because I've heard some musicologists apply logic like Stefan Zucker's and play these terminology games like Stefan Zucker plays, and they get taken seriously. And maybe that's part of our problem. Maybe if we just had the ability to say, without giving an opinion about whether or not this is a good way to do things, If we just had accurate ways to describe things, maybe it would be just a little bit harder for people to play games. For people to waste an incredibly huge amount of resources entertaining exactly nobody. Like, I have to wonder, do people go to this and the ones who are saying that it's great, you know, they paid for this and they're like, oh, awesome. Do they really feel like it's heroic? Or do they feel like it's, I don't know, like they're part of a performance where we say it's heroic but like the real performance is convincing yourself that this is heroic. Like, and the fact that you're able to do it makes you one of the elite opera goers in a sense. You're an elite consumer of art because you're able to go and hear Klaus Florian Vogt, and because he identifies as Heldon, it sounds heroic to you. And maybe you're lying through your teeth when you tell others that it sounds heroic to you, but it doesn't matter because nothing means anything. So, I don't know. Maybe I'm looking into this too much. Reading into this too much. So Kane, I can't speak to his connections. I don't know about that. But that would be a great thing to put on the list of what can I do better? What can I steal from this guy? And so you know, because I'm sitting here going, well, I think I could do better. And I'm trying my best not to rag on some guy who's more successful than me and just look like I'm that guy. But I am that guy. And I mean okay, fine. I think I'm a cool version of that guy, though. Let's just say. So Kane, that's interesting. So you think so there's a market for this sound, is what you're saying. But what I want to know is, why does lead sound like this? What? Who are the people that want lead to sound? I don't want leader to sound like this. I like if I want to hear Winterreise, I'm putting on Hans Hotter. Or like, I'd love to hear Lawrence Melchior singing Winterreise to me. Spannengesang. But I don't think I'd like to hear Klaus sing those things to me. I think there's a very small number of things I'd like to hear him sing to me, because I don't particularly like operatic tenor singing without metal in it. I think it's almost like not worth it. It's not even worth having a concert to me. I'm not into it. It's not like I only like metallic singing. I love non-metallic singing, like in other genres. I love, like, you know, Taylor Swift. I mean, don't tell anyone, but I love Taylor Swift. Right? But I don't need Taylor Swift when I go to Lohengrin. That's the thing. Well, Ian Bostridge was my, I guess that was when I was a kid, when I was like a student, he was kind of a big deal singing his leader stuff. And I hated it, but I didn't realize was, I guess I was blocking it out, but the Met was coaching me to sound like that too. So it was, and then I was in this weird, it was like Desdemona from This Is Opera. So I was like hating on Ian Bostridge, but I was sounding pretty Bostridge-y. Yeah, there's old recordings. And then you can find recording. I need to find that stuff. But I have stuff from when I was like 20, 21 or something, singing Cielo e Mar, and it's all metallic, and it's all lyric. And then you come back in like 5 years, and I sound not like this, but I was more using a lot of curbing. So still metallic, but this kind of half metallic vocal mode. But anyway, so I guess I'm gonna leave it there. I hope I don't get canceled over this. I was gonna try to leave a cliffhanger for what I'll cover tomorrow. I'll do something tomorrow though. If you guys wanna have some input, let me know if there's something you wanna cover tomorrow. It's Sunday night. Sunday night usually has got, oh geez, this thing is getting really, this is why we gotta stop, because this thing is getting crazy. It needs to go outside and do the things dog do. You need to do things dog do. Yeah, you need to do that, yeah. Okay. So, but I've given up completely on ever being able to like sell ads on my channel or anything like that, and it's none of the viewers anyway, in the topic. So I'm gonna try to do more videos reacting like this, watching some more in-depth clips. And then I figure as long as I can get the videos unblocked, like the last one we did on screaming and other rough vocal effects in opera is really annoying because it gets blocked. Like they don't just do copyright notice and then it's like, well, you can't monetize your video. They do a copyright thing and then they block it so no one can see the video. And it's total bullshit. And who blocked it was Arena di Verona and their Tosca video. It's such BS because it's totally, what I'm doing here is totally fair use. Now the dog is
setting off. Oh my God. The dog is, oh good God.
You guys, this is, oh my God. Oh my God. Yeah, I'm just going to have to go here because, anyway, the real Mr. Opera at gmail.com. Send your requests.
Dovrebbe un cantante servirsi della voce di petto?
No.
The straw.
It's just a straw, right? It's not just any old straw. We've sized it very particularly, you guys.
So the SMBT Straw Pro comes with a minimum of 40 resistance configurations in one device.
And then we have two straws that are the exact same size, diameter, and length. And this is so that we have options.
After you've practiced the exercises for maybe 5 minutes,
you'll see here that the vocal cords aren't in sync with each other.
You have to put more work within the body to just get things going because the straw isn't providing you with enough.
It is very important that you let no air escape around the straw between your lips or through your nose.
But the thing is with that, it cuts off the nasal resonance part of singing, which is very important to singing.
It's almost as if you're trying to release it out through the straw to whatever's in front of you.
You will find when you go back to normal speech that your voice seems to be coming out of your eyes instead of your throat.
If you are splashing yourself, you're creating volcanoes, and that is not allowed.
A wise man once said, there is a sucker born every minute.
No, 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 no. Oh, hell no.
So just grab a straw.
For those of you who talk several hours a day and your voice gets tired, here's a tip to keep you talking. Press your voice like this.